All right, so welcome back everybody to our C++ programming lecture. What are the topics of today? Let's have a look. So today we are going to discuss about template metaprogramming, which by some people is considered a bit esoteric. So maybe you can make some good use of it and maybe you don't. Depends also on what kind of domain you wish to go for in your career later on. But anyways, I really feel it's a good thing to know how it works conceptually, and sometimes it can even be a bit useful. So sometimes you probably wish to use it still. So we'll talk again about template metaprogramming as promised in the last lecture. We also talk about variadic template arguments. In the last lecture, we already talked about variadic function arguments, where you could implement a function which takes like an arbitrary number of arguments of the same type. And how we did that was we used the special std initializer list type that has been introduced in C++ 11, and we made that a parameter of our function of the desired type. And then, for instance, I give the example, I believe a function that can take arbitrary number of integer arguments, for instance. That's really quite useful sometimes. And you can abstract one more layer, so to say, by making it variadic template arguments. And then that also allows you to not only provide an arbitrary number of arguments of the same type to a function, but also of different types. So even the types can be arbitrary. Sometimes that turns out to be useful, sometimes it doesn't, so, but just so you know. And at last, we will talk about smart pointers. Many people already ask, why haven't we used smart pointers? I read something about smart pointers on the internet. Yeah, bear with me. Today we are going to discuss smart pointers too, and how you can use those things, and yeah, how to improve your code using smart pointers. All right, but let's first of all start with template metaprogramming. So what is template metaprogramming? First of all, that might surprise you even. So template metaprogramming is a Turing complete language even. So C++, of course, in itself is a Turing complete language. And template metaprogramming is or can be considered as a kind of separate language within C++, which is still also Turing complete. So you have a Turing complete language in a Turing complete language. So it's like kind of inception, right? So that's somewhat unusual. And what does Turing complete mean? I mean, you can look it up on Wikipedia, for instance, but basically what that means is every intuitive computable number can be computed using such a Turing complete language. As template metaprogramming. So you can compute everything. And it might not be particularly easy to compute anything using template metaprogramming, but it can be done. In this lecture, I will show you how to compute like Euler's number using template metaprogramming, but you can get far more advanced. You can just look it up on the internet, everything. And but I believe there was one guy who implemented like the compile time Tetris game within template metaprogramming, which is a short TMP. No, but it's kind of insanity, but it can be done. So meaning basically you can compute pretty much anything using that kind of stuff using TMP, but that also has some mathematical funny implication, which means there cannot be a correct C++ compiler, whatever that may mean. Again, you can look it up on the internet, but for your day-to-day life as a software developer using C++, so that should not be of your concern, but that's more like a mathematical thing. Luckily, not so relevant for real-world practice, right? So, and here's a funny meme. One does not simply learn template meter programming, not since a pure functional programming language was found inside of C++ compiler's template mechanism. So it has been discovered. So it was not built in on purpose. It has been just discovered as a kind of accident. So sometimes it's a funny word. Again, already mentioned that it's by some people at least considered a bit esoteric. Some software companies don't even allow it. It depends. It depends. Then on the other hand, you have like application domains where you use every dirty trick available to make your program fast, which gives you an advantage over your competitors in the field, in the respective field. So that's another story. It depends highly on the company you're working in later on, and what the specific domain is they work on, right? So there are some users, and there's even a Boost sublibrary called Boost HANA, which is your standard library for meta programming. So if you wish to go into that dark route, you can look up Boost HANA. There will be also a special lecture here in the C++ programming course where I present to you some of the, I don't know, most important, might not be the right wording here, but some of the very useful C++ libraries available. And in that lecture, I also present to you the Boost library collection, the Boost libraries. And Boost has dozens of sublibraries, and one such sublibrary again is Boost HANA, which is a library for template meta programming that you can use if you wish to do that. Since C++ 11, there's not so much, or I mean the number of scenarios where template meta programming would be sensible to use could luckily be reduced since C++ 11. Maybe that's a good phrase or a good way how to put it, because const expr functions have been introduced in C++ 11. And since C++ 14, you can even write arbitrary code, arbitrary functions, and declare them as to be const expr. So you can work things out at compile time. And you can use ordinary C++. You don't have to fall back to template meta programming. Why to use const expr over TMP? I mean, you will hopefully see why that is on the next few slides, where I also present to you how to compute Euler's number, and you will see things start to get complicated. But before we can really talk about TMP, we need to mention and introduce one more thing that is kind of the prerequisite that you need to know in order to discover TMP. So maybe let's try to rediscover TMP, and then finally we can use it. Because what I have not yet presented to you, probably, at least not that I recall, is the following. If you define your own data type using struct or using class, you can of course have member functions and data members. And there is the keyword static that you can apply to members of a type. So you can have static member functions, and you can also have static data members. And what does it static mean here in that case? If you declare a data member to be static, that means that this data member is shared across all variables of that very type that you define. And in other words, that static means, so if you have a static data member in a type, in a struct or class type, that means that the static data member belongs to the type itself. It really kind of is similar to global variables, but with limited scope. So a static data member of your struct or class type is really like a global variable, but with limited scope. So meaning you need to access that variable through the type, through the data type. And that's great news actually, because now if then the variable which can hold a value, if the static variable which of course can hold a value, belongs to the type itself, then types also of course can store values, because we just give it static data members and those are considered to be part of the type, and then those can still store values, and so types can store values. That's a good thing. And with values, of course, we can perform computations. And so we can perform computations with types. And no, you probably already see it coming. Templates and the template mechanism, those do allow you to like modify types, right? So templates are processing types. And yeah, we now just have discovered template metaprogramming, right? So we use templates to process types and we give those types static data members which hold values, and then we can use the, or we can, I don't know if I should say use or misuse the template metaprogramming or the template mechanism to compute things, right? So let's have an example of a static data member. So what we can do is, for instance, we can create a struct A, which we give a static const integer value, and we can directly initialize it in C++ or in the more recent C++ standards, and we can just set the value to some value, right? So, and what's special about that value, because it's static, that means that value exists. Oh, no. Is that correct? Exists only once across. Ah, yeah, okay. Yeah. So there's only one value which is available across all variables of that very type A. Okay. So you could, for instance, declare two variables of type A and B, and then you can directly access A.value, and it will print 100 because yeah, you just initialized it to 100. But you can also print B.value, and it will also print 100 because that variable value that is shared across all instances of that uppercase A type. And even stranger is, you don't even need an instance, right? Because that exists as a global variable, so to say, with limited access through this type A. So you can also just type A :: value, and then it will give you that value which you initialize to 100 again, and it will print 100. So you don't even need a concrete instance. It's just part of the type. It's like baked into that type. So that would be an example here how you could use the static keyword within your struct or class definitions. Okay. And template metaprogramming is a functional language which computes by using pattern matching and recursion. So you don't have if-else. Instead of if-else, what you do is you use some kind of pattern matching and recursion typically. So instead of if-else, you use pattern matching. And instead of loops, like if you need to do a thing multiple times, you instead replace it by recursion. I don't know if you know the language Haskell, or I mean some functional language that of that sort. They also do the exact same, so they're using pattern matching and recursion instead of if-else and loops. And okay, so let's have an example really. Let's compute the power function by using TMP. So how do we do that? Of course, we need a type because, I mean, the template mechanism operates on types. So we can create ourselves a nice type called power. I don't know, maybe let's make it a struct here. And we, of course, need templates because it's called template metaprogramming. And this power template should get two parameters, one integer b, which is the base, right? And one unsigned e, which is the exponent. And then we try to put the base b to the exponent e. So we wish to compute b to the power of e. How do we do that? Now it gets a bit tricky, but bear with me. So, as a data member of Power, we now have a static const integer value which we initialize to some computation here. So what should that value be? So if someone uses the Power type with B and E and provides some template arguments here, what should that be, that value? That value is B times, and then whatever Power of B and E minus 1 colon colon value is. Okay, so that is the recursive case. So we say, yeah, the value of B to the power of E is B times, and then whatever that thingy here is. And of course, the compiler doesn't know that as well. That's a bit unfortunate. So what the compiler then does is it instantiates that template as well. So the compiler will generate a type, a power type, for whatever B and E minus 1 is, and then access the value, which in the recursive case will once again be B times and then power B power of B and E minus 1 colon colon value. And if the compiler also doesn't know that, then it again instantiates a type, a template, to figure it out, right? But that doesn't lead us nowhere, really. We still need one base case. So again, as for the ordinary recursion we saw on applied with ordinary C++ functions, we need to decrease the problem size. And we really do that by decrementing that e here, the exponent. So we make it smaller. So, and the idea is that the compiler unrolls all those templates here until a base case is reached. But we don't have a base case, so let's better introduce a base case. And that is our base case. We can now also say, we can create what is called a template specialization. So we can create a type power. I mean, that is in essence the same type here, struct power. But here we say that is a specialized template, a template specialization, for the case where we only wish to have that variable B and that E is 0. And for the case in which we have some base, we don't care what base it is, can be arbitrary, but where the exponent is 0, then we define that value as a static const integer data member and initialize it to 1 and set it to 1. Because something to the power of 0 is always 1, right? So that is the base case. And the compiler will now, I don't know, if you call that power, do we have an example? Yeah, here we have an example. So let's compute 2 to the power of 10. How would you write it? You would do the following. You would first of all have a variable on the left-hand side, because I mean the answer will eventually be a value. So you have a const int p. And then you use your type. That is still a type. And you give as template parameters, I don't know, here for instance 2 and 10, so 2 to the power of 10, and then you access the value which carries the result eventually. And at compile time, so while the compiler compiles that code, the compiler must now evaluate that thing. And so what do we have? So we have 2 to the power of 10. So value will be 2 times power of 2 to the 9 colon colon value. And the compiler also does not know what that is, so it instantiates that template. So it will create a type for 2 to the power of 9, which in fact will need power of 2 to the 8. And so it will unroll and unroll all that good stuff until the exponent will eventually be 0, and then the base case is reached. And what you basically end up having here is that you have value is 2 times 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 2, and eventually it will be times 1, and then it ends. right? Then the recursion stops, and your value p will carry whatever the result of 2 to the power of 10 is. And then you can print it here, for instance. And because templates are templates is a mechanism that is evaluated at compile time, that basically means that this number here will be computed at compile time. So please once again recall that in C and C++ we have a separate thing. So we have a compile time where we compile our program, where we give the compiler our source code, and it will produce our final binary executable. That is compile time. And then at runtime, when we run that resulting binary, that is runtime, right? So, and the cool thing here is, because we are computing that number at compile time, the very number here that we compute is baked into the final binary. And if you run your program, if you run your binary, that number does not need to be computed because it has already been computed at compile time. And it's just used. It's baked. The final answer is baked into your program, which makes your program faster in the sense that it doesn't have to do that computation at runtime, right? All right. Okay. And that's the same code once again. And so let's like recap here. In programming using templates, types are used as functions, right? Yeah, you already figured that we kind of misuse types as functions. You can get some input parameters, the results are static data members, and yeah, then you guide the control flow using recursion and pattern matching, right? So types are used as functions. They can get as input types, constant values, here, constant values, right? References to functions as well as input parameters. And then they can also store a type with typedef. They can store a constant with enum or static const, like here we used static const int to store a constant. And template specialization, which is that thingy here, where we specialize that power template and define that value to be something different for the special case when E is zero, right? And in our case, or in our example here, templates get instantiated until the base case is reached, and then the compiler figured it all out at compile time, and then it will bake in the result into the final binary. However, I mean, that, of course, hopefully you all agree, but that looks a bit nasty. That's in C++ what I always say. It's like at some point it becomes a mess of arbitrary tokens, or at least that's how it looks like to, at least to me. You may have a different view on things, but yeah, so that's a bit tricky. But what you could also just use is you could also use a const expr function to compute stuff at compile time rather than misusing the template mechanism here. So instead, you could also just create an ordinary C++ function called power, just give it an integer argument base, an unsigned integer argument exponent, and then, I mean, you can still also use recursion, of course, if you like to. So that's in essence the same recursion here. And you just declare to be a const expr function, which can be evaluated at compile time. And then a call to that function is just power. And I mean, that's just ordinary C++ as we all know and love it, right? So power 2 to the power of 10. And the result is stored in P. And then you can also use P. So semantically, that is equivalent, right? But I prefer the right-hand side version because it's much more readable, and that is natural C++, and that is like misusing templates here. And mis in parentheses here. And I mean, it's the same thing. So that call to the power function, because the arguments 2 and 10 are known at compile time, they are known statically, that resulting value here, which is stored in P, that will also be known at compile time and will be baked into the final binary. Okay. All right. What else? You can, in template meta programming, you can even realize data structures, and then it gets really nasty, but it can be done. You could also just use templates for instance, implementing the triple data type, which I asked you to do in the current exercise sheet, I believe. C++ also has a tuple data type, which you can use by including the header file tuple, so hash include and then in angular brackets tuple. And the tuple data type is also implemented using template meta programming to make it efficient. Lists, for instance, again, are also possible. Yeah, I mean, data structures are possible, and lists are a kind of data type. So that all can be done. Now let's get a bit more advanced. If you don't know what the following means, and I mean, that's not a problem. I can like explain to you the basics, and then I also have to pass, probably, and then you can read it up on the internet. So there was some crazy guy from which I kind of borrowed that example. And just to show you a more or less cool example. I mean, cool depends on your definition, right? But computing Euler's number may be considered cool. I don't know. We wish to use that formula for E, for Euler's number, which is like the following sum. And if you spell it out, it's like that. And then it's an infinite sum. And if you compute that, which you can't do, of course, because it would require an infinite amount of time, but that thingy is exactly E. And what can we do in computer science, where we only have a limited amount of time? Of course, we can just compute an approximation, and we can just compute the sum here, not from 0 to infinity, but I don't know, from 0 to a large number. So depending on how close we wish to tackle the real E, right? So let's compute that using template meta programming. And here I pasted the link, so you can also, I hope that's still available. I haven't checked, unfortunately, but you can look it up if you're interested in that kind of thing. So how do we do it? First of all, we need fractions, right? Because the sum was expressed in a sum of fractions, right? So for a fraction, we need a numerator and a denominator. So we need two input parameters, n and d, and then we represent a variable of type frac as, I don't know, as frac. And then we have two constant integer data members, numerator, denominator, which we kind of initialize with the given arguments here, with the given template arguments. Then if we then write or spell out in our program frac 2 comma 4, that is in fact a fraction that should represent 2 over 4, which would be 1/2, which would be 0.5, right? So far, so good. Now let's also create a little machine, a template meta programming machine, so to say, that allows us to multiply a fraction, a frac, with an integer. And here again, I already mentioned it somewhere on the last slides. With typedef, you can kind of store a value, so to say. So what we do is we here typedef a frac and say, yeah, we would like to multiply the f's, and hopefully f is a fraction. That is a template argument, a template type argument, which hopefully will be a frac at some point. And so we say, yeah, that frac that we typed f here as a value, that should be a new frac where we compute x times f and then the numerator, and x times f and then the denominator. So yeah, I hope you know what that means. If you don't, I mean, it's not too bad here. So then we also compute a little, or we also spell out a little machine which computes for us using template metaprogramming the greatest common divisor. So you can give it two integer arguments, and then it can compute the greatest common divisor. And we also need a base case for that, where like the y is zero, and then it's just x. And otherwise, it's that guy here in the recursive case. And what else? We also can create a little machine which we call Simplify, which takes a frac, and then it computes the greatest common divisor, and then it kind of creates a new fraction here with that type def, which is simplified, right? So we just divide everything by the greatest common divisor. That would be the case which I set or presented in the beginning, where you have like 2/4 can be simplified. Greatest common divisor is 2, and then you can simplify to 1/2, which is exactly a half, right? So far, so good. But then you can also, I don't even know what that does. Same base, it probably, what does it do? Do we have, okay, same base. Yeah, no, it gets more complicated, as you see here. But yeah, then stuff happens, right? So we can also then create a sum, which we need. So a little tool that allows you to sum up two things. And then you simplify. So that's probably to allow you to add like fractions. You can give it two fractions, and then it makes it the same base or whatnot, and simplifies and computes the sum. Yeah, probably something like that, at least that looks like it. And we need more. We need also factorial, which is relatively easy. Factorial is just, yeah, you give it some template parameter, which is an integer value, and then you say, yeah, that value in the result, in the very end, should be n times whatever factorial n minus 1 :: value is, and then it gets recursive, right? And then you have a base case where the where you have like factorial 0 as a special case template specialization, where you say, yeah, then in that case, the base case, the answer would be 1, and then that lets allow you to compute the factorial. And now finally, you can have that e, so you give it an integer number, so like that is the upper limit for the sum, and then it, yeah, does that magic here. And then you apparently also have a base case. If you request like as the upper limit for the sum 0, then in that case it would be just frac 1 and 1 value, so it would be just 1, and then you can use it, right? So then you can say, yeah, I would like to compute e using that sum up to the 12 like operands, like 0 to 12, and I use 12 as the upper bound for the sum. :: value, that is your x. And then like the last division you have to do yourself, so you can then access x :: numinator divided by x :: denominator, and then that gives you a relatively good approximation for e. So, and really it feels like that thingy here, take it or leave it, that's what you can do with template metaprogramming, at least. And you can even go more advanced, but like it's, you need to be concentrated to write such code. Crazy. Yeah. Okay. But we can use this more sane alternative. We can, I already mentioned that we can use also constexpr. So using the same formula, we can just have a function factorial, which computes the factorial of some given unsigned integer n, and it's also using recursion, so no problem at all. And then we declare that function to be a constexpr function. And then we can have another function which is called Euler, which gives us, according to the same formula, for a given upper sum limit, so to say, unsigned integer n, it computes like Euler's number, with the helper function factorial. And now also we make it the const expr function, and then we can just call the ordinary C++ Euler function without having to use any of those template metaprogramming madness. And then we have our const expr double e, which then carries the Euler's number computed with that formula. And that is evaluated compile time and baked into the final binary. And so let's double check on that just to be sure. So let's see what the compiler does. We can compile that program here with the following command. In order to obtain LLVM's compile, the LLVM compiler's intermediate representation. That's what I previously showed you from time to time. And that is what the compiler has internally as a representation of that main function. And you see here we have a double on the stack, which is exactly that e here, that e variable that is denoted by %2. And we see that the compiler allocates such a thing on the stack, and then it stores a literal, a double literal in hexadecimal into that variable, right? And that here is exactly Euler's number, where the upper limit of that formula is 10. Right, so if you can just enter that in some web browser tool, and it will be able to convert that back to you into double hexadecimal, double decimal representation instead of hexadecimal. But that's exactly our value as a constant. So no call to Euler takes place. That already happened at compile time, and then your program contains just the final result. So that worked out exactly as we wanted it to. So then, pros and cons using template metaprogramming. Evaluated at compile time, which is a good thing, so less runtime things that need to be done. Higher abstraction possible. Yeah, that's also great, and for some domains you need that. But of course, on the negative side, here on the con side, longer compile times, right? So if the compiler needs to do some heavy work at compile time, it takes a bit. It really takes some time to compile your binary. And hard to read, hard to write. If you're not an expert, or I don't know, have lots of experience with that stuff, hard to read, hard to write, to say the least. That functional style does not match standard C++, which is an imperative language, and then all of a sudden you should just use recursion and it's a pure functional language. Very limited support by development tools, which is, yeah, which makes it harder for you. Error messages. So if you misspelled something or if you introduced an error, then the compiler will give you, of course, compiler error messages because it can't compile it, because it would be computed at compile time. And the error messages usually are very hard to read, so typically they make no sense, which is a bad thing, and oftentimes it's also heavily overused. And once again, you have no type information when using TMP, because recall the Euler number computation here, where I showed you some things, and where, for instance, for the multiplication, right? So the first argument was an int, which is perfectly fine. But then the second argument was just type name f, so an arbitrary type. But we expect the user to give some fraction type as an input. And if the user gives something else, it's pretty bad. So it can't be checked that easily. So by default, type information are not really, I mean, type system can't really employ it here. So instead, try to use C++ const expr functions, unless you have good reason to do otherwise. So there are some good reasons to do otherwise. And some of my very, very good colleagues from Saarland University, Florian Sattler, he has a very advanced course, C++ course on, or what was it, generative programming or whatnot. And at the very end of this course, I will definitely try to make his materials available, or I ask him to do, and then we can check if we can make at least his slides available to you, because that would be a very good course to follow up on this entire C++ course, and Florian will really in his course present all the advanced stuff in C++, which is really great. If you wish to go that route and become an absolute C++ guru, then that would be a good thing to do for you, I guess. All right, but for now, bear with me. that was TMP, I guess. So, kind of. So now let's see how we can use templates to implement variadic template arguments. So what we can use is the following. Templates not only allow you to use template arguments like that first one, type name t, where t is a type argument, but you can also have the following, where you have type name dot 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 and then args, and that is what is called an argument pack. So you can call the sum function with one type, and then you can give it arbitrary many other types, template types, which is stored by the compiler in which is treated as an argument pack. That should be fine. So, and what you can, for instance, do is you can implement a sum function, which takes one type argument t, one argument of arbitrary type t, and then it takes an argument pack of the remaining types, right? So you basically have some arbitrary other arguments here of arbitrary types, and you implement your sum to be like, what should be the result? The result, first of all, should be of type t, and you say, yeah, that function should compute t plus, and then we recursively call that sum function, and what we do here is we use args followed by dot 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 that unexpands the that expands the argument pack and basically calls the sum with the remaining arguments recursively. And then that thingy here is applied again recursively. So then again, the first argument of those guys here is t again, and then the argument pack gets reduced by one argument, and then the compiler will apply recursion again until you at some point reach a base case, which would be that one, where you have a sum and only a single parameter, t of type uppercase t, which you specify here, and then it just returns it. So, and that would be a way to compute a sum of arbitrary things that must support operator plus, right? So because we're here computing using operator plus. So whatever types, whatever variables of whatever types you provide here as arguments to the sum functions, they need to support operator plus. So if you do it for all integers, that is perfectly valid. So you could then write sum and then 1 to 10, the arguments, and then the compiler will generate a sum function using the template mechanism that takes in as parameters 10 integers. And then we'll reduce the remaining things here to 9 integers, so it will also create a sum function that works on 9 integers, and all the way down to a sum function which takes only one argument, which is then 1, which would just return the argument itself, sorry. And then you have a nested expression, which eventually evaluates to 55. All right, which you can then print here. So that would be a way to, yeah, I don't know, implement functions that take arbitrary many arguments of arbitrary types. So you could here, for instance, also give some double or whatnot, and it would still kind of work, but yeah, be very careful here. And the compiler can oftentimes deduce the template parameters. So for that sum function, we don't even need to spell out the template types here. The compiler will figure it out for itself. Most of the time, if the compiler is not able to figure it out for itself, then it will throw an error at you, and then you can specify it yourself. And hopefully you can make your code compile at some point. Since C++ 17, there's also something which is called fold expressions, which you can apply to argument packs. So here we have a template argument pack args. And we have a function that takes some number of arguments of some types. And here we can use those arguments and unexpand it like that. So we can say args plus and then dot, dot, dot. And that automatically is a fold expression. So it would apply operator plus and would combine all the template or all the arguments of those arbitrary types here. So that is also possible. That is semantically the same as the left-hand side thingy, but you don't need to use recursion. You can just use the fold expression, which has been introduced in C++ 17. What else? Maybe let's also have a function that is able to print everything. That is what we also presented in the last lecture. So let's have that print arbitrary many arguments of arbitrary type. How would you do it? First of all, if we don't use the C++ 17 fold expression, we would use recursion doing it like that. So we would have a function which we, I don't know, call print everything, for instance, which receives one template argument t or one variable of type t and then some other variables of arbitrary types args. And then we print that t and call ourselves recursively with the remaining arguments, which we expand here, and then the compiler will generate the required print everything functions from that template here, from that function template. And of course, also we have a base case in which we only give one argument of some type t, which we then also print to the command line, and that would be our base case, which ends that recursion. And then we can, for instance, call our print everything with a string literal, with an integer literal, with a double literal, with a stud string here, which we initialize to world. And so that call to the print everything function would then just print all of the arguments here. As long as the left shift operator is overloaded for those types, right? Because please do recall, whatever types we put into here, we use the left shift operator here, which is overloaded for the output stream on that variable of some type. So the types need to support that left shift operator here. If the variables or the types basically do not support the left shift operator, then the compiler will throw an error at you and will say, yeah, I don't know, if you, for instance, put an instance, a variable of your own data type X, let's say, as a parameter, and it does not implement that left shift operator, the compiler will tell you, yeah, that there's no overload for that data type X, and then you better fix your code. And the same thing as on the left-hand side can be also expressed using C++ fold expressions, where you use stut cout and you print that t, or is it even correct? No, that should be args, probably. Yeah, it should be args, sorry. So instead of the t, that must be args, that variable here. And so you print that to the command line, and then you you have a fold expression over that comma operator, and then it just prints every argument to the command line, to the character output stream here. All right, that should be more than enough on template metaprogramming and variadic function arguments and all that kind of stuff. You rarely need it, but if you need to use such things, you can now look it up here and you now have a good starting point on my slides. And for all the details, of course, you have to look it up on the internet, right? It's hopefully clear to you that I can't present in this lecture to you all the very details, because then that would be an infinite lecture, because the C++ programming language is so large and so huge, I can't tell you everything. So I can only give you really the basic idea. And then if you're interested in details, you can look it up for yourself. I guess you already figured that. All right, so now let's discuss some very useful thing, which is called smart pointers. So what are smart pointers? Pointers that are smart. How is that even possible? So let's see. So what you already have like in your mind is raw pointers, right? So you know what raw pointers are. You can have value types, you can have a variable I of type integer, and you can, I don't know, initialize it to 42. And then you can also have pointer types. You can have a pointer to an integer that is a variable IPTR of type pointer to an integer. And you can store in that variable the address of I. And then that pointer kind of points to the variable I because it contains its address, contains I's address. And pointers are necessary for dynamic memory allocation. That should be dynamic memory allocation. Because if you use operator new, for instance, it allocates some memory on the heap, possibly also initializes it, and then it gives you as an answer a pointer to that very memory, which you then can store in some pointer variable, right? So for instance, like that. So here a heap allocation takes place, an integer is allocated on the heap, and then the address to that heap allocated integer to that piece of memory is given to you, and here then you store it in a pointer to an integer variable called dynamic int. And then you can use it, and at some point you need to delete it, otherwise you leak some memory. You have a memory leak in your program, which is not very good, especially if you have some long running programs. Those would then consume ever more memory until at some point you would just kind of fail. Your program would crash if you allocate in a loop, for instance. And so at some point you will delete what is stored in that pointer, what the pointer points to. And so then you get rid of that heap memory again, and you can potentially reuse it, or the operating system can also give it to someone else. I don't know. That's how you do it. So the same also works for arrays. You can ask the operating system to allocate on the heap like 12 integers, and then you will be given a pointer, which you can also store in some other pointer variable, a dynamic array, for instance, and then you can use it. And at some point you use array delete. Please use array delete because you used array new to get rid of that heap memory again. And so what was the problem here? I mean, that's perfectly fine if you use it correctly, but the problem is that you don't use it correctly. At some point, and believe me, that happens sooner rather than later, at some point you will probably forget to use delete, either ordinary delete or array delete at some point. And finding memory leaks is really expensive because you need to have quite some long debugging sessions depending on the complexity. Of course, nowadays we have that great tooling like Clang's sanitizers, we have Valgrind and all those memory analysis tools, which is great, but still that's kind of unnecessary, right? And it's still expensive. So the idea here is that, you should rather employ something which is called smart pointers, or oftentimes in short SP or SPs. And those smart pointers are really safe wrappers for raw pointers, which help you to organize and manage your memory such that you can't leak anymore. And you also can't have a double free if you employ those smart pointers correctly. So before I talk you through how to use these smart pointers, maybe let's talk about the underlying problem. Because the underlying problem is really the following. The problem has to do with the ownership problematic. So who is responsible for a piece of memory? That has to be clear at some point, right? So if you allocate some memory, who's responsible for deleting it? And that's what I mean with here ownership. So some guy must be responsible for that piece of memory, and some guy must delete it after it is no longer being used, right? So let's, for instance, have the following example. It's just some random example here that came to my mind, so bear with me. I should just show you a proof point. So let's create a function which we call matrix multiply, and as input parameters we get two pointers to matrices A and B. And then we allocate a new matrix that should hold the result, and we do allocate it on the heap using new. So we would allocate a new matrix type and with a sufficient size in order to hold the result. Then we are given a pointer to that heap memory where the matrix is stored, and we store that address here where that matrix resides on the heap in the pointer variable C. And then we can perform our actual matrix multiplication, which I have not yet shown here. Or I mean, just for showcase here, so I have no implementation. But at some point after we computed the matrix multiplication, then we just return a pointer to the heap memory, which stores the resulting matrix, which now also contains the result of the computation A times B. So we return a pointer. And the problem is here that within the matrix multiply function, we allocated that new matrix, right, for the result, and we just give a pointer as a return value. And the question here is, who frees that matrix C again? So that has been allocated in matrix multiply, right? So we have an allocation here. But now the question is, who frees that allocated memory that is behind that C pointer that is returned as an answer? I don't know. Who does it? What's for certain is that it has to be deleted at some point. Otherwise, your program would leak, right? So, and the problem in general really is, who is responsible for that matrix that is returned here as a pointer? Who owns the resource or resources? Meaning, who allocates memory and who frees it after its usage? And there are basically like three strategies that you can employ. So what you can do is that that your caller allocates and your caller frees, which for which an example is given here on the right hand side. So you could also implement your matrix multiplication, which works like the following. You give three pointers to matrices, and the intent here would be to have the matrix multiply function multiplying A and B and storing the result in the matrix that is denoted here by the C pointer. And then you would just write the answer in the matrix that C points to. And then this function would not be concerned with memory allocation at all. Here, in that case, it would be expected that the caller allocates, so the caller of that function would allocate all those matrices, and the caller would also free all those matrices if no longer in use. But that's very fiddly, I would say. So there's another strategy that you can see here in the above, where the callee allocates, so the callee would be the matrix multiply function, right? And the callee allocates, yes, it does, because it has that new here, it allocates a new matrix. And then it returns a pointer to that new allocated heap memory. And it is then expected that the caller frees at some point. That would be yet another strategy. And we could also have callee allocates and callee frees. So that is kind of like what is implemented in std string and std vector. Right, I already mentioned that a bunch of times to you, or several times to you. Std vector is basically just the safe wrapper around a dynamically allocated array on the heap, which can grow and shrink in size and has some other useful functionalities, right? And so you would just create a variable of type vector, and it would do the allocation under the hood for you. And once that vector variable v goes out of scope, for instance, because you're returning from a function where you used that vector, then the vector would automatically delete what's on the heap, right? So that would be the third possibility, where the callee allocates and the callee also frees your memory. that can also be done. So, but we have to decide on what we use and what we expect here. So someone is responsible for the heap memory. Someone kind of owns it. And smart pointers help to express the ownership, like who owns what resource. And with smart pointers, you really can express the ownership problematic or the ownership of that memory. So smart pointers know who owns what resource. And smart pointers do the cleanup for you. Smart pointers know when to call delete themselves. And now you wonder, how can smart pointers know when to delete something? They automatically call the destructor for the managed resource if the managed resource has no owner anymore. So once you don't have any owner anymore for the piece of heap memory, the smart pointers will call delete on the pointer to that resource. In most of the times, it's just memory, are no longer used by anyone. Okay, so how can that work? Still, how do the smart pointers know when a thing is no longer in use? Smart pointers call delete for the object that they are managing or pointing to when their own destructor is being called. So we will have an example or a few examples, in fact, on the very next slides here. So, but in essence, smart pointers know about ownership. And please also be aware that this is not a real garbage collector. It's just under the hood. It's just implemented as reference counting, which you could denote as the poor man's garbage collector. But it's not a real garbage collector, which runs as its own process, as for instance, in hosted languages such as Java or C sharp or what have you. Here it's just reference counting, so to say. And that also means that you only pay for the counter variables and incrementing and decrementing counters. So it's pretty cheap to use smart pointers. So there's no extensive garbage collector that must be run and analyze all your heap structure and all that good stuff. And also, by the way, it is still possible to leak resources in Java, although it has a real garbage collector. And the problem here is you kind of, if you own upwards, then you're basically lost and done, and then the garbage collector can't collect that memory. If you're interested in that, just look it up on Google. There will be probably some examples for that. So, smart pointers. There are three of that kind, so three different types for those smart pointers. So there is unique pointer, which can be used to denote unique ownership, meaning one user at a time, so that heap memory only belongs to one user at a time, and that user then is responsible for that piece of heap memory. There's also something which is called shared pointer, which is used to express shared ownership, that shared pointers are used to kind of share a piece of heap memory across multiple users. And then once that heap memory has no users anymore, then that is deleted. That piece of memory is deleted. So that is for one or more users at a time. And then you have a weak pointer, which is for non-owned things. So a weak pointer is basically a smart pointer, which is only allowed to look at things, but it doesn't own, right? So it does not own, but is only allowed to use the underlying object. So the weak pointer, that is not commonly used in practice, really. So most of the time you only see really unique pointer and shared pointer. I also give you an example on weak pointer, but it's rarely used, to be honest. And so shared pointers are implemented in the STL, so you just need to include memory, the header file memory, and then you get, then you can use all those different types of smart pointers. So, let's first of all start with std unique pointer, which allows you to manage resources with one owner at a time only. So, and unique pointer behaves much like an ordinary pointer. Let's have an example. So how can you do it? First of all, let's have some user-defined data type, for instance, which we call data, and it should have two double variables, x and y, as data members. And then we just also give that data type here a constructor, which accepts two double variables as arguments, x and y. And then it uses those constructor parameters x and y to initialize its own data members x and y, right? Okay. So, and what we can now do is the following. We can write such code here. What we do is we create a variable of variable called data pointer, which is of type std unique pointer to data. So here that unique pointer, it accepts a template argument. So meaning that is a unique pointer to data, and that is the variable's name. And here we allocate some memory on the heap. So here we allocate some instance of our data type, which we initialize with 12.5 and 14.8. So those data members will be initialized with those two numbers. That sits on the heap, so we now have two doubles allocated on the heap, and the address where that memory piece of memory has been allocated on the heap is stored in the data pointer variable, which is a unique pointer. So on the heap we would have two double variables initialized with those numbers here, and then the pointer would be stored in that variable data pointer, which is on the stack, right? So that is on the stack, and it points to the heap. And if you run that code, you don't have any memory leak. So that's perfectly valid code, no leak whatsoever. And the question is, how does it work? We don't use delete explicitly. So no delete is being used. And I'll explain you how that works. So the unique pointer manages the memory resource here, which has been allocated on the heap and stores its address, right? And that data pointer variable is placed on the stack. And at some point, after just right before the program exits here at return zero, the data pointer goes out of scope, right? So it, because we are leaving that function, the stack memory is cleaned up automatically. So that's also why local variables are also oftentimes referred to as automatic variables. And when that variable goes out of scope, which is of type unique pointer, its destructor will be called. And the destructor of unique pointer is implemented to delete the underlying resource. So when the data pointer goes out of scope, that heap memory will be deleted because the destructor of unique pointer just calls delete on that pointer here that is managed. Right? And then you're done. You automatically delete it, so to say, at the right point in time. So you can also use that without new and use a factory function. There's also a factory function which is called std make unique, which you give some type that it should allocate, and then you can give some constructor arguments here. That is kind of a factory function. You can also look it up on cppreference.com. And so that will also automatically allocate on the heap and will initialize here, call the constructor with those arguments, and will also return a pointer, which is then stored in data PTR of type unique pointer. And once again, if the data PTR variable of type unique pointer goes out of scope at the very end of main, then delete will be automatically called on the pointer, and then the heap memory is freed automatically, so you can't forget it. So be aware that std make unique only has been introduced in C++ 14. It has been kind of forgotten in C++ 11, In C++ 11, just use new instead of using that factory function. And when I say just has been forgotten, maybe let me put it the way it actually works here. So there's no need for calling make unique. Make unique is unnecessary here for unique pointers. New, allocating with new here is semantically exactly equivalent. But there's something which is called make shared, which will make a difference. And then for, yeah, like being coherent, one has later on introduced make unique as well. If that only confuses you what I just said, then just ignore. You can use here make unique as a factory function, or you can just also directly use new. Doesn't matter, at least for unique pointers. So that is unique pointer in essence. And the question now is, how is it really implemented? Because here my ideas to discuss how it could be implemented. It should just give you a mental model how it is implemented, or how it is essentially implemented, at least conceptually, and that hopefully helps you to understand how to use those unique pointers. So if you had to do it yourself, if you would need to implement your own unique pointer, how would you model it? You would probably make it a class that providing a pointer to the resource, right? So you would model it as a class which has as a data member a pointer of some template type T, which points to the heap memory that you should manage with that unique pointer, right? That only sounds reasonable. And how do you ensure that the data pointer only has one user at a time? How would you ensure that? What you could do is, and I already mentioned that possibility to you, you can disallow the copy constructor and the copy assignment operator by setting them to delete. So you can disallow copying the smart pointer, and you can kind of disallow the copy constructor and also disallow the copy assignment operator and set them to delete here. And then a user is no longer allowed to perform a copy. And that way you can be sure that you only have one user at a time. And if a user tries to copy your unique pointer, that results in a compiler error. And the compiler will tell you, hey, you can't copy that type. That's not allowed. And how is the data pointer able to delete its resource? I already mentioned it a few times, and but cannot be mentioned often enough. So it uses the destructor. So in the destructor of unique pointer, it calls just delete on the pointer data member resource that points to the underlying resource, in that case to the heap memory here, right? So and then the resource is automatically cleaned up for you. And now the question is, because we now deleted the copy constructors, but how to use it elsewhere without copying? How does that work? And here the answer is, yeah, use move. You can still use the move constructors, and that way you are kind of making sure that you only have one user at a time. And if you wish to use it somewhere else, and you wish to somebody else to take care of that unique pointer, you can move it to a new user, which is then responsible. So wherever you move it, that guy is then responsible for the resource. So that helps you to model ownership. You can only have one user at a time. Copying is disallowed. And if you wish to have someone else being the new user, you would still move it to the new user. And that implementation that concept here should just give you an idea. So the actual implementation would be a bit more advanced, of course, but that's the underlying idea, really. So how to use smart pointers and what about dereferencing them? The great thing is that in C++ you can overload all operators and you can pretty much overload almost all operators. So that also means that the operators on those smart pointers have been overloaded, such that the smart pointers behave exactly like raw pointers. So you can still use the error operator. You can also dereference a unique pointer. That's also perfectly possible using that one here. So you can dereference it. And why that works is because the operator, the dereference operator has been overloaded. And you can also dereference and access a member of the managed resource. That works by using the error operator here, the kind of pointer operator, right? All those operators have been overloaded to make the smart pointers behave exactly like raw pointers. So and here we have that scenario where we have different users. Let me talk you through. So the idea, I mean, this piece of code won't work. That is, that's wrong here. Because why is that wrong? What we do here is we allocate memory on the heap using new. So we have two double variables, x and y, within the data type here on the heap. And we also initialized them using 12.5 and 14.8. So that's on the heap. And the pointer that the operator new returns, where that memory resides, is stored in a unique pointer called dataptr. That's a variable. And we have also implemented a small function which is called set0, which takes a unique pointer, as an input, and sets both components to 0. X and y are set to 0, and then it returns that very unique pointer. So our data pointer we wish to pass into the set0 function. But the problem is that the set0, that would actually lead to a copy, because here we are passing an argument of type std::unique_pointer. So by default, the copy constructor would be called, which is disallowed. So the compiler would throw an error at us, saying, yeah, I mean, you can't just call the set0 function with that data pointer, because, I mean, that would require a copy, and copies are disallowed here for that type. So this does not compile. I already mentioned to you why that is. Because copying would result in more than one user, because then you would have the data PTR as a user of that heap memory, and you would also have D, the parameter D within that function, as a second user of that heap memory, which is, again, not allowed, and that is why an error is thrown at you. So here we would have two owners, which is disallowed. Main and set0 cannot be both the owner at the same time, at least not using unique pointer. So how do we fix that? We move the data instead of copying it to only have one user at a time. So we use std::move to move that data PTA data pointer to the set0 function. And then back from set0 to main. So that way we make sure that we only have one user at a time. So here would be a fixed version, where we move our data pointer into that set0 function. And here we return, we set both components to 0, and then we return here that unique pointer D, and again store it in 0. please be aware that that second move happens implicitly. So we can just return a unique pointer here. We could also like write std::move D here at this place, but that happens automatically, because in that case nothing else would make sense. So that second move kind of is hidden. So we have the one move, std::move, that we must write explicitly, saying that we wish to move the data pointer to set0. That basically means that set0 is now the owner of that underlying heap memory. Set0 is responsible for cleaning up eventually. But then set0 at the very end returns that unique pointer again to a variable I mean, it returns it, and then the caller of the set0 function stores the return value in the in another variable, 0, of type unique pointer, and then that 0 variable is responsible for that piece of heap memory, right? And also be aware, once again, I'll explain it to you, if you have moved data from a variable, you are not allowed to use that variable again. That data pointer you just moved to the set0 function. That means after you have moved from data pointer, you are no longer allowed to use data pointer here because there is nothing behind it anymore. It has been, its contents basically have been moved. Okay? So yeah, that's how we make it work using std::move. So that works now. Do not use data pointer after you've moved it somewhere else. I just mentioned it because, yep, it's pretty bad. And the second move, I already also mentioned that, is hidden. It's hidden in the return basically here, but you don't have to spell it out. And set0 moves that D variable here back to main into a fresh variable of type unique pointer called 0. And do not worry if you forget move somewhere, the compiler will complain if you forget to move. And then the compiler will tell you, yeah, at that place I can't copy that. Try move instead. So don't worry, you can't forget using move. The compiler will mention that to you in form of an error message. And eventually you can use, of course, the components here, x and y. And yeah, I mean, 0 will be printed, right? Because those have been zeroed out by the set0 function. So it's not a particularly useful function, but it should just prove point. And at the very end of that main function, 0 and also data PTR go out of scope. That means the unique pointers call their destructor, or the destructors are being called for those variables. And there's nothing anymore behind data pointer because we just moved from that. So that would be a call of the of delete to a null pointer, which doesn't do anything. And then if the destructor for that 0 variable would be called, it's implemented to delete the underlying resource, which basically are those 0 out numbers then, and that is removed from the heap. That's deleted. And so you automatically cleaned up that mess without calling delete explicitly. That's the idea. Okay, by now I hope you at least got the concept here, good idea of the concept, why that could be useful. And that was unique pointer. And unique pointer is the scenario where you only have one user at a time. Sometimes it's also useful to allow for multiple users at a time, which is also implemented, and that is implemented in a data type called shared pointer, which allows for multiple owners. So how does that work? Let's have the same example again. So we have also our data type data, still carrying two double variables, still having a constructor, which accepts two double parameters, which are used to initialize the data members. So far, so good. And then we still can have our set0 function, but now we just replaced here the std unique pointers by std shared pointers to allow for multiple users. And how you could write such code is as follows. So you would allocate some variable of type data on the heap, and then the respective constructor would be called, sorry. And then so that is allocated and initialized on the heap. The resulting pointer is stored in data pointer, that variable, which is of type shared pointer. And then we pass that data pointer to the set0 function. We modify the data here a bit, and then we return it back to the caller and store it in the variable called 0, also of type shared pointer. And then we can, for instance, access the data using the 0 shared pointer here. And Does that work? Yeah, it works. We don't need any move. Copying shared pointers is allowed. That's perfectly valid. So, and shared pointers keep track of its owners using an internal counter. So you have an internal counter variable, which now does reference counting. Because using shared pointers, you can have multiple users. And those multiple users are basically just counted in a counter variable. And whenever you perform a copy of a shared pointer, the use counter goes up. Whenever you perform a copy, then you have yet another user. And if a variable of type shared pointer is destroyed, for instance, it goes out of scope, it's popped off the stack. If its destructor is called, then the use counter is decremented. It's minus one, right? And as soon as the use counter, the reference counter, reaches zero again, that means has no user anymore, then that means the managed resource on the heap is deleted. So as soon as the use counter falls to zero, it's cleaned up for you automatically. And whenever you perform a copy, the use counter is incremented. So here set zero can be now used without std move because copying shared pointers is allowed. In that case, the use counter would be incremented. What else? So yeah, it can be copied. We allow for more than one user. Exactly. So let's have an improved example. Okay, here it makes a difference. Here we are using, in that line, we are using make shared instead of new. And using that factory function is a performance improvement. Because, please take a deep breath and see and think about where the use counter must be stored. The use counter stores the number of users, right? And it can be incremented on copy and can be decremented if one shared pointer is destroyed, so to say. And as soon as the use counter is approaching zero, it also destroys the underlying resource. And now the question is, where is that use counter stored? On the stack? Can't be, because on the stack, only one shared pointer could access it at a time. So the use counter is actually also stored on the heap. The use counter must be stored on the heap as well to make it accessible to all shared pointers that point to the managed resource. And if you would just allocate a data type here, for instance, if you would just allocate something of type data on the heap using new, then that would be one allocation. And the shared pointer implementation would then use a second new allocation for the counter. And in terms of memory, that might be somewhere completely different. And then you would have your data at some place on the heap and your reference counter, your use counter in some other place on the heap. And modern machines really don't like memory that is often accessed like together somewhere completely else. So modern machines like if something exists or is being used, which is called data locality. So data that is commonly used together must be kind of next to each other in memory to make your program faster. We will at some point in this lecture series also will have a lecture on high performance computing and such things and optimizing your programs. And then I will explain a bit more why that is and why that matters. But the keyword here that you can Google for is called data locality. Data locality. Because then you can make use of your caches in your machine, in your mother machine and all that good stuff. And so if you use make shared, then the make shared implementation will allocate the data that you requested to allocate on the heap and the use counter directly next to each other. It will be in one chunk of memory on the heap. So if you use make shared, it makes a difference in the sense that it allocates both things next to each other, which is like optimal. So that makes a difference. So performs only one allocation for data and reference counter, exactly. Data and reference counter sit in one block of memory, exactly. And that is more efficient because of data locality. And let's now have a look on how you could actually implement a shared pointer for yourself. Of course, the actual implementation again would be much more advanced, but that should give you at least a pretty good idea. And you would now, I mean, after having discussed that slide, you would be able to implement your own shared pointer if you ever need that. Probably you shouldn't use it because the STL version would be much more advanced. But how would you model it anyways? So again, you would probably make it a class that provides a pointer to the resource, to the heap memory it should manage. That would probably be a data member of type pointer to a T, and T would then be one template parameter. How to store the number of users or references? You would store them in a counter variable, which resides on the heap. How to copy? You would just perform a flat copy of the handle, and you would not copy the managed resource. So what that means is, if you copy a variable of type shared pointer, you would just copy the pointer to the resource, but you wouldn't copy the resource yourself. And also on copy, you would also increment the use counter, because now you have kind of two pointers pointing to the same piece of heap memory. Exactly. So increment the reference counter on copy. And when to delete the resource, you would implement your destructor of your own shared pointer type. If you ever need to implement something on your own, you would implement the destructor to decrement the reference counter and also check if the reference counter after decrementing it is zero. That means that you have been the last user, and in that case you would delete the resource. And otherwise, if you've decremented the ref counter and you are still not zero, then you have still some other owners kind of left, so you are not allowed to delete the resource just yet. But that is basically that basically means the last guy cleans up here. Okay, so let's have an example. Once again, same situation, set zero function, we have our data type data, and then we have a main. At the main, we allocate some variable on the heap of type data, and we initialize it with those numbers, and we call make shared to do that. And that would mean that on the heap, you have now the two double variables, which are needed to represent a thing of that data type data, which are initialized with 12.5 and 14.8. And then you, in addition, because you used make shared, you directly have the counter variable associated with, within the same heap memory, within the same piece of heap memory. And that is on the heap. And a pointer to that heap memory is then stored in the stack variable of type shared pointer called dataPTR. All right. And then you can, for instance, call the setZero function, which you give as an input parameter, the dataPTR function, variable. And that would mean that you have now a second user, because not only do you have your dataPTR pointer that points to the heap memory, but you also copied the shared pointer into the setZero function. And that means you have a second user now, a D, which is in that set zero function, which also points to the exact same heap memory. And now you set the values to zero here. And at some point you are returning from set zero, so that user goes away here. So it's gotten rid of, but you still have one more user data PTR, so that D here is not allowed to destroy that heap memory. And you have a new user yet, because that return value of set0 is stored in the 0 variable, also of type shared pointer. So that means that you have now two users that make use of the same kind of heap memory, same resource. And at the very end of main, both of these variables, data PTR and the 0 variable of type shared pointer, go out of scope. And their destructor is being called. So zero's destructor is being called, it decrements the reference counter, and it finds that, okay, there's some more user of that memory I'm not allowed to delete. And then data PTR's destructor is being called, and the ref counter is decremented, and now it will find that, oh, okay, now I was the last user, now the ref counter is has reached zero, and now I call delete here and delete the resource, and everything is cleaned up for me. That is how it works in terms of shared pointers. So for completeness, maybe now let me also just briefly explain using one example how you can use weak pointer, but already mentioned that it's not very commonly used in practice really. So a weak pointer can hold a reference, so to say, but it is not an owner. So let's have an example. Let's have a global variable of type weak pointer to an integer, and let's call that a global weak pointer variable WP for weak pointer. And then we have a function f, and in function f we do the following. From the weak pointer, we try to lock it, and from the weak pointer, we create using lock a shared pointer, which we can then use, and here in that case, we dereference the shared pointer in order to get the underlying integer, which is printed. But you can already see that here within that if, we also perform a check. So when the shared pointer that we get from the weak pointer using a call to the lock function. If that shared pointer here, if that evaluates to null pointer, could namely also be that lock returns null, then we reach the else case, and that means that the weak pointer is expired. once again, I told you that the weak pointer is only allowed to look. It is not an owner. So it could be that you wish to have a weak pointer to a thing, or that you have a weak pointer which is looking to a thing, but the underlying resource has already been destroyed or deleted because it doesn't have any real owner anymore. And then the weak pointer basically doesn't have anything. There's no underlying resource anymore. And so that is also why it could be that weak pointer is expired, which is indicated here by that member function lock, which returns a null pointer in such case. So let's have an example. Let's have the following. We have a main function, and with the main, we just open a new scope. And in that new scope, we allocate using make shared a shared pointer on the heap. And that shared pointer points to an integer, which we initialized to 42. So we now have an integer on the heap, initialized to 42. And the address, the shared pointer, variable is here sp, that is shared pointer. And now we assign that shared pointer, which manages the freshly allocated heap memory. We store that in the weak pointer, meaning that the weak pointer is now also looking at that resource. The weak pointer is now looking at that resource. And then we call f, and f tries to lock that weak pointer, which will succeed in that case, because here that shared pointer exists, right? And it is an owner of the resource, so the resource still also exists. And so we are allowed to look at it, and then here, if we dereference the shared pointer that we locked from that weak pointer, if we dereference that, that will print 42. And everything works fine. But now let's see what happens next. Now the scope is closed again, Meaning that the shared pointer here at that point, at that closing brace, the shared pointer goes out of scope. And because it was the only user, we only had one shared pointer to that thing. There was no copy being performed whatsoever. So there was only one shared pointer to that pointing to that resource. So in its destructor, the resource will be cleaned up as well. So the heap memory will be freed. And now we call F again. And from that weak pointer, we try to lock. But the underlying resource has already been deleted. There's nothing much, there's nothing anymore. So that lock fails here and it returns a null pointer. And then we enter that second, the else branch here where it prints to the command lines that the weak pointer is expired because it the memory doesn't have any owners anymore. It has already been cleaned up. So you can also type that into your favorite IDE, compile it, and see for yourself how it performs, what it does. But that is what happens here, as I just explained it. So in reality, you rarely use a weak pointer. A weak pointer to be used must be copied into a shared pointer. Already mentioned that, and yeah, I'll just leave it there, I guess. So maybe a note on smart pointers now. Smart pointers massively reduce the probability of introducing memory leaks because smart pointers do the cleanup yourself, and which is a very good thing. And you may think, okay, I mean, we now have those seemingly complex smart pointers, but they're not that complex at all. Why do we actually need them? I mean, for now, at least for the exercises, we probably have been able to manage the raw pointers for yourself pretty easily, right? So you did one allocation, and then you, as a result, you get a pointer that points to the heap memory, and then at some point you would just call delete, and it's easy, right? I mean, of course, for your very simple like here exercises, that was always easy because the programs have been really, really small. But imagine you're working on a larger software project. And imagine you also allocate new, not only in sequential code, but say you have a loop where you allocate with new, and then you have some pointers to all those different pieces of heap memory. And if you really work on a larger software project, those pointers are passed to functions. Some other function is then passed to some other function. Then you have your pointers to the heap memory all over the place. And you maybe even have several raw pointers pointing to the same resource. And then it's really hard to figure out at what point delete must be called and by whom and how many times and all the good stuff. So for large real world software, it gets really hard. And it turns out we are pretty bad at keeping track on who owns what. And exactly for that ownership problematic, which is the underlying problem here, really, those smart pointers have been kind of invented or developed, which help us managing resources. That is the idea. So always prefer using smart pointers when managing resources. So try to use smart pointers. Prefer unique pointer if you only really have one user. There's no need to have shared pointer. If possible, however, if you have multiple users, then of course use shared pointer. Custom deleters are also possible. So the default implementation of unique pointer and shared pointer in their destructor just calls delete on whatever address you give it. But maybe you have a special situation where a call to delete would not be correct or is not sufficient. Please look up std unique pointer and std shared pointer for those things here. You can also register a custom deleter. And when you construct a unique pointer, you can also give a custom deleter, which is then called once the resource is no longer being used. And then you can not only call delete on that resource, but you can also do different things and register your own deleter, so to say, if you ever need that. But I already used it, and that is sometimes quite neat to have that. Smart pointers themselves behave like raw pointers. All the operators are overloaded, so you can dereference it. You will see pointer operators, so to say. You need just a tiny little bit more memory in case of the shared pointer, because then you also need to store that counter variable somewhere, right? And yeah, only fall back to raw pointers if you cannot afford a few bytes more per variable for the counter variable. If your platform does not implement an STL or does not provide an STL implementation, I'm not sure if Xbox and PlayStation implement or provide an STL implementation. I'm not sure. But yeah, I mean, if you don't have an STL, you can't use shared pointers, right? So you could then either implement your own or just manage everything by yourself, right? Or if you implement algorithms, then of course it's perfectly fine, perfectly valid to use raw pointers, right? And there may be several other reasons, other good reasons why not to use shared pointers or smart pointers in general. Then of course you can also use still raw pointers, right? Okay, so with our current knowledge of smart pointers, let's have some more notes on dynamic memory allocation. If you have to dynamically allocate objects, use smart pointers when possible, whenever possible. Stored unique pointer, stored shared pointer. If you have to dynamically allocate an array of objects, use stored vector. Because I already mentioned that stored vector is just a wrapper type around a heap allocated array that can even grow and shrink in size. So whenever you need a dynamically allocated vector on the heap, array on the heap, use vector. Whenever you use, whenever you need a single dynamically allocated object, use smart pointers. And also, please do not think there are no exceptions to that. Okay, raw pointers are still needed. Yeah, when implementing algorithms, for instance, and if you're only a user and not an owner of a resource, so many people, rather than having a weak pointer, they just provide a raw pointer when only when only looking at things as an alternative to weak pointer. That's commonly used in practice, really. All right, so almost done. So what is the current status here, status quo? You know now very much about modern C++, really. So you made quite some progress, so you can be proud of yourself. That's pretty much you by now. So you know all the basics and you have detailed knowledge on where to find information like CPP reference, Stack Overflow, all that good stuff, right? So you are now able to write your own C++ programs. You probably know more about C++ than your older professors who learned like the early C++ standards like 98 or whatnot, but you learned modern C++ and you know all the cool and fancy stuff that make C++ a relatively easy to use language. So if you had to use C++ using the 98 standard, it would be a whole different story. I can tell you that much. And so what next? So if you now already have a good overview, what's next? We now have to deepen your knowledge. There are still some more lectures to come where we talk about optimization. We will also talk about the different memory classes once and for all. Then we are done with memory. So memory classes, we will also talk about object-oriented programming, which is really useful oftentimes to model your problem or model solutions to your problem. So object-oriented programming we will discuss, static analysis, and so there are some more topics to come which are very interesting. So, and those all help to deepen your knowledge. And there will also be a summer exercise sheet for 16 additional bonus points, so to say. If you need to make up a bit, feel free to solve the summer bonus exercise sheet to get 16 additional points. Already mentioned that we will talk about object-oriented programming. We will also talk, and that's very important nowadays, about threads and asynchronous tasks. So that's I will show you how you can use C++ to run computations in parallel. Because even your smartphone probably has, I don't know, 8 cores or whatnot. So therefore it makes much sense to to know how you can implement a program that runs certain tasks in parallel to make use of all your hardware and all the cores that are available on your machine to make your program run as fast as possible. So we will talk about threads and how to run computations in parallel. That is nowadays really, really important. We will also talk about high performance computing and optimizations and all that good kind of stuff to make your programs fast. We will talk about static analysis that will give you a very good idea on how your compiler works internally. And that will help you to see your program with the eyes that your compiler sees your program. So if you know about static analysis, that is very helpful, I would say, to write good code that your compiler can then understand and make the most of. And of course, job offers. So if you wish to write your thesis, bachelor, master thesis, just send me an email and I will dispatch that into our research group. Also, we are oftentimes looking for student assistants. So please also just drop me an email if you are looking for a position as a student assistant. No matter if you already have a bachelor or if you don't, that's no problem at all. Just ping me. And then eventually I will, of course, introduce you to the final project. Exactly. And then I will present some hacks and some fun miscellaneous topics to you. Yeah, that would be pretty much it and would be pretty much the timeline for the next lectures here. You can also watch a recording of a very nice talk by Bjarne Straustrup that recaps everything that we had so far and probably also a bit more. So don't be afraid. Here's the link. So maybe you should have a look at it. And yeah, then let's recap for today. So we talked about template metaprogramming, variadic template arguments and ownership problematic. So who is responsible for that resource? Who must clean up the data or the resources? And then we talked about how smart pointers help to mitigate that problem. Talked about unique pointer, shared pointer and weak pointer. And yeah, basically talked about the status quo and what is still to come. All right, then thank you very much again and see you in today's exercise class. Bye-bye.